friends, I'm Dr. PVSM Gauri. I had been working with the Ministry of Commerce for implementation of the NPOP program for exports for 15 years, and recently I have joined a social enterprise, Round Glass, which has a concept of imparting health and well-being of human beings. Today I'll give you a small concept of organic products before we start the journey, holistic journey, about how organic products are produced and what are the requirements for the products to reach the market, and what are the potential products in India, and what are we producing and what are we eating. Before we start this topic, I just want to tell you, what are organic products? Organic products are produced without the use of any chemical fertilizers and pesticides, and that is why they are considered to be a pure products without any chemical loads in it. Why we have gone for organic agriculture? Organic agriculture because the farmers have been using indiscriminately the pesticides as well as the fertilizers, resulting in residue problems in the final product which we eat. By the time it reaches our plate, it is full of chemical pesticides or of heavy metals, resulting into various kinds of chronic diseases, especially cancer in children as well as in the adults. Let me give you the concept of organic agriculture. The International Federation of Organic Agriculture Movements, which is an international NGO, has defined organic agriculture as it combines tradition, innovation, and science to benefit the shared environment and promote fair relationships and good quality of life of all involved. That is, the living plants, the farmers, the producers, the processors, as well as the consumers. Why it is so significant? What are the statistics, the significance of organic farming? It is economically viable due to input cost reduction, because as per the concept, the farmer need not buy anything from the market. He develops the requirement of his crop within the farm itself. That leads to economic viability for the farmer. Ecological backlash in irrigated areas, it helps in that. Niche products, agribusiness enterprises for export, because it was considered to be a niche product and is still considered to be a niche products in our country. So it is helping the entrepreneurship. Earlier it was for export, but now it is also for the domestic market. Related pesticide diseases among farmers and consumers, which are prevailing, can be reduced or can be eliminated by organic farming. Organic farming mitigates the climate change. How does it do? Climate change is because it reduces the carbon footprints, and that is how it mitigates the climate change. Contributes to the health of the nation by facilitating safe and nutritious food for consumption. There are four principles of organic farming. The principle of health, as we have already discussed, because organic agriculture should sustain and enhance the health of soil, plant, animal, human, as planet, as one and individual. So the entire ecosystem, the entire planet, is benefited. The principle of ecology, organic agriculture should be based on living ecological system and cycles, because God has created the cycles, God has created the ecological system, so we should not try to change it. So we have to be worked within the system and emulate them and help sustain them. Third important principle of organic is that the principle of fairness. It should build on the relationship that ensure with regard to the common environment and life opportunities. The fourth most important, equally important principle of organic farming is principle of care. It should be organic agriculture should be managed in a precautionary and responsible manner to protect the health and well-being of the current and future. See, our great-grandfathers, they at that time, no chemicals were there. They were so healthy. They never had any major health problems. We have been discussing about organic farming and sustainability. So there are three major aims in organic agriculture. One is economic, the other is social and ecological. So there are three sustainability aims in this process. First, we will discuss about the economic aims, because economic security to the farmers, because he need not buy anything from the market. He can produce the requirements, the inputs for his farm within the farm itself. It is economically viable because as he need not go for a weeding process or buy weedicides or anything. So it is economically viable. It adds value. It gets a premium in the market. And the most important is that good working condition. Farmer need not handle any chemicals and fertilizers which he has been inhaling and affecting his health. Low investment, as it is already discussed, and good and constant yield. Once the organic farming is established, once the management is get initiated, it will get good and constant yields, the farmer, and it will not come below the production which is expected for his farm. Low external inputs, make best use of the local resources, and low ecosystem balance. So these are the economic aims. Now coming to the social aims, fair trade, ensure food supply, satisfy local needs, because the farmers, they can give the food, as I discussed, the food miles. It gives safe, satisfy the local needs of its consumers. Gender balance, organic farming also aims at gender balance. Generally, both the male and female are given equal status. Respect the local culture, because already traditional practices are prevailing. It is being adopted with a scientific background, that's all. Do taste and quality and the safe products. These are the social aims. Now coming to the ecological aims, it gives the ecological balance, no chemical pollution, high soil fertility, clean water, biological diversity, animal friendly husbandry. Animals also a part of the ecosystem in organic agriculture. So the farm animals are also treated in a different way, which we'll discuss later. So animal friendly husbandry and conserves the natural menus. So these are the three most important sustainability aims if we go in for organic farming. The next important part of it is the market. So this, I gave you just a background of organic farming. Why organic products? Why should we eat organic products? Why should we practice organic products? And what are the sustainability aims of the farmer? How does he get benefited by growing organic produce? Approach for organic agriculture. It focuses on improvement of the soil fertility by natural means. If the soil is healthy, there will be less infestations of pests. Pests should be there because God has created pests, the predators to some other enemy. So the concept is that you should not eradicate pest, but you have to prevent or you have to balance the pest in nature. So if you improve the soil fertility, there will be less insurgence of pests. The second approach is balance plant nutrition through recycling of organic matter and locally available sources of nutrients. When you recycle the organic matter which is being produced in the farm and convert into a manure, which again becomes a nutrient for the plant. So we balance plant nutrition through recycling of organic matter. Agroecosystem approach, cover crops, crop rotation and intercropping. Cover crops are mostly used for to prevent the crops during the adverse conditions. Crop rotation, always if only monocropping is there, then the production decreases, the pest might increase, and that is why crop rotation is always preferred. Because after every crop, there is a depletion of the nitrogen content in the soil, converts the elemental nitrogen into the nitrogenous compound, which are a nutrient for the crop, for the soil. So crop rotation is generally followed by the organic farmers, by the main crop followed by a leguminous crop. Intercropping to have more sustainability, to have more income to the farmer, intercropping is generally preferred. If there is a gap between the plants, the cropping pattern is made in such a way, is planned in such a way, the farmer also grows intercrops, so he gets two products, the main crop as well as the intercrop. So this is the agro-ecosystem approach is also followed in organic farming. Preventive measures, biological pest control and mechanical weeding. So mechanical weeding is generally prohibited or avoided. And preventive measures are taken for controlling the pests, because as I said before, that there is a balance of the pests in the nature. The cycle can be maintained by releasing the predators, and which becomes a food for the next generation of pests. So this is how there is a balance of pests in nature. Organic fodder for livestock. Livestock is an integral part of organic farming. So the livestock are fed with organic fodder. The livestock are not being given antibiotics. If there is the animal is dying, we can give them antibiotics to save the life of the livestock. But at the same time, there is a process of withdrawal period, and then only we can use the milk and other things from the livestock. Animal behavior, animals are also need to be treated very well, especially the farm animals. We should not irritate them, we should handle them properly. So animal behavior is also one of the important approach in organic farming. So this is the background of organic farming and why it is important nowadays and what should be the approach, because generally there is a myth in the market. Myth in the minds of people that not using chemicals is organic farming. No, organic farming has to follow certain principles. You have to work with the nature, and the product produced will be organic, and it should be, you know, there's a connection between the producer, the handler and the consumer. So this is what about organic approach. Now coming to the global market. The global market started in around 2000, especially the Western countries, they are very health conscious. They started going for organic products, and the present market is $80 billion of organic, and the major markets are US, European Union, followed by European Union, China and other countries, and India comes in the category of other countries. The annual growth of the global market is around 20 to 30%, but still the market share is only 1% of the total food sales in the global market. India's share, you see, it is 0.25% of the global market. We produce the certified produce, what we produce, around 1.35 million metric tons. And we have exported last year around 26,000 metric tons, and it is around 26% of what it is being produced. The rest is consumed in the domestic market. These are the figures of 2016 of International Federation of Organic Agriculture Movements. Now coming to the system of implementation, because organic products in 2000 was a niche product. There was not much concept of organic farming in our country, and there was no market. So there was a demand of organic products from the Western countries. That is how the Ministry of Commerce implemented NPOP, organic production, under the FTDR Act, Foreign Trade Development Act, in 2001. It was mandatory for export of organic products to follow certain rules. This is being implemented by the Agriculture Process Food Export Development Authority, which comes under the Ministry of Commerce. Later, the domestic market started growing on its own, and people have started understanding about organic products. There was a demand of organic products. So that is how NPOP was also implemented by the Ministry of Agriculture under the Eggmark Act for the domestic market. But Eggmark Act is voluntary. So those who want to go for organic certification, they need to go under Eggmark for the domestic market. Those who do not want to, only they can name the product as organic or green products and whatsoever. So it was voluntary. But now the Food Safety Authority has a mandate of food laws. So it is being developed, this NPOP is being developed as a mandatory standard for the domestic market. It is in process. What does NPOP contain? This is a huge program, and it has been implemented very successfully by Ministry of Commerce, and EPIDA is the implementing agency. It contains policies for development and certification of organic products, because as I said, morphologically every product looks the same. How will you differentiate between an organic and an inorganic product? So a certification process is required. So that is how it contains. This program also contains policies for development or certification of organic products. Then how it should be produced? So there are standards for organic production. It also, there is a rule for accreditation or certification. Everybody cannot become a certification body. There is some mandatory requirement. There is some mandatory qualification for a certification body to certify organic products. Presently, we have 28 certification body. India started in 2001 with 4 or 5 with international bodies operating in India. Once the NPOP was implemented, under the FTDR Act for export, the government have started accrediting certification bodies. Now we have only 8 international bodies, we have 10 state certification bodies, and we have 10 private bodies who are recognized by Government of India for certifying organic products. Government of India is also encouraging development of organic cultivation as well as processing. Because finally the consumer, not only the produce, it has to be added some value. So these are the 4 things involved in National Program for Organic Production. The same is being adopted by FSSAI, and it will be implemented for the domestic market. Presently, it is only mandatory for the export market. The export market from production till it goes out of the country is being monitored by EPIDA. For the domestic market, till now there is no such regulation, so it is in the voluntary till FSSAI notifies NPOP for the domestic market. So you all can get this copy of NPOP on the website of EPIDA, www.epida.com, which says National Program for Organic Production. And the same is being adopted, so you can refer this NPOP. It contains several chapters. The various terminologies used in organic farming and the regulations, they are defined in the chapter definition, that is the first chapter. The second chapter gives the scope and operational structure of NPOP. This structure is only for export purpose. It is how the national accreditation body works, how the certification bodies are being accredited, and the various policies involved in it. The third chapter is the heart of NPOP, because one has, those who want to follow organic production, they have to follow the third chapter, that is the national standards for organic production. The national standards of organic products contain many things. Again, crop production separately, then animal production separately, aquaculture production separately, all these things can also be, all these products can be produced organically. So third chapter of NPOP is the most important one. The fourth chapter, it gives about what are the rules for a certification body to operate and what are the requirements of a certification body to be recognized. So the term used is accreditation of inspection and certification agencies. The fifth chapter is certification of grower groups. You all know that our farmers have got very small land holding. So going for certification is very expensive. So the farmers cannot go for certification. Groups of farmers can together be certified. So there is a guidelines given in chapter 5 where group of farmers around 25 to 500 can be certified in a group for organic product. But there are rules in it that they have to have contiguous land, they have to produce the same crop, they have to have the same planning management plan, they have to have the same type of production. So there are certain guidelines given wherein group of farmers can come together and get certified under group certification. There is an organic certification mark known as India Organic Logo. This logo is being developed to signify that the product which you buy is organic. But this organic logo is being developed for export of organic products. But however, due to awareness of organic products in the domestic market, the consumer started recognizing this organic mark to be a product in the market. So now automatically, even though there is no regulation, even though there is no rules for any certification or any mark, but still farmers started regulating or recognizing organic certification mark, that is the India Organic Logo, and it is seeing that people are ready to pay a premium and buy the product. The last chapter is appendices, which is relating to the standards. What are the things can be used, what are the things cannot be used, because for commercial production you need to have more inputs. So there are so many commercial inputs are available in the market, so it gives what to be used and what not to be used. And there are certain formats for the producers, formats for the processors, format to sell. How do you sell the product from, because there are several stakeholders in the chain from the production till it reaches the consumer. So there are various formats being developed. When I buy and when I sell, there are certain rules to be followed, and these are the formats given which one has to follow. There is a certificate for the farmer group or for the producers to say that this is organic, they are following organic principles, which is given by the certification body. Similarly, when it is processed, there is a process of certification that the producer, the processor is following the organic principles in processing. Again, there is a certificate for a handler or a trader who is handling the products. He also gets under the coverage of organic certification that he is dealing with organic. So there is a traceability of the product flow from the farmer till it reaches the consumer. And Ministry of Commerce, as I said, EPIDA has developed a traceability system, online system, wherein all these stakeholders involved, the producers, the processors, the certifiers, they all work, and then there is a traceability that the product flow has come from this producer group and it has reached the market. So there is a traceability system known as TraceNet. So these are the highlights of NPOP. Well, now I would like to familiarize you with some of the ISO standards, because apart from the organic production standards, the stakeholders involved in the process like certification bodies, testing laboratories, then accreditation bodies all have to follow certain international standards for recognition. ISO 17065 is for confirmatory assessment bodies, that is the certification bodies operating product certification systems like organic products. Unless they qualify to this, they are not being recognized by Government of India. So ISO 17065 is requirement for the certification bodies. For the accreditation bodies, like EPIDA is an accreditation body, for recognizing the certification body, it complies to ISO 17011. ISO 17025 is the requirement for the laboratories for recognition. Then ISO 17020 are the requirements of bodies performing inspection. Their role is only to go and verify and comply and see that the compliance is requirement has been fulfilled by the producers and by the processors. So they had only for inspection. 17021, again, requirements for management system for the certification board. These are the bare minimum requirements who wants to get into the system of organic certification, accreditation, as well as testing of organic products. So NPOP has been very, very successful for exports. NPOP has been recognized by the trading partners. US, which is the biggest market for us, they have recognized NPOP. Any product which is certified by the certification bodies under NPOP are being recognized, and the food which is exported is being accepted in the US. Similarly, in EU, they recognize the agriculture products, and no other certificate is required. So these are the two, and there are other Asian agencies which I think the government is working to for recognition, for a mutual recognition. So what are the key factors in establishing the credible NPOP? The regulatory environment with focused objectives, aims, and interlinkages was established. That is how it has established the credibility. Stringent standards of production and their implementation. Accrediting body, that is a PIRA, is doing the surveillance on the certification body. So the chain of reactions. So every step is being under the surveillance. So the strict standards and strict implementation is also one of the most important factors which for establishing credibility. Compliance for accreditation, for running and certification program, this is most important. Suppose a person is qualified to certify a product, but he doesn't have an establishment to run a system, then he cannot be accredited for certification of product, organic products. So ISO guide defines what are the minimum bare requirements for an organization to become a certification body. Establishing the conformity assessment procedure as per ISO 17011. Capacity building of all the stakeholders. We have to build the capacity of all the stakeholders, the producers, processors, handlers, implementers, even the government bodies. They all have the capacity building is a very important process. And strengthen the process of certification through traceability. Traceability is the key mantra of the market. Consumer wants to know from where this produce has come, who has produced it, and what I am eating is clean food for which I am paying a premium. So traceability is most important. Traceability has been established for export. The same traceability has to be established for the domestic market for the satisfaction of the consumer. Essential components of organic standards. I'll just give you a brief one. The details are given in my slide. Crop production requirements, there is a conversion period required when conventional farm, when it gets converted into an organic farm. The entire farm is required to be designed, it has to convert. So it takes minimum 3 years if earlier the farm is chemically abused. If the farm is not chemically abused, then it requires less time period, 2 years or minimum 1 year. If it is a forest area, an area where no chemicals have reached, it requires 1 year. If it is, there have been judicious use of chemical fertilizers and pesticides, minimum 2 years is required. These are all given in detail in the third chapter of NPOP. Disease management, how the disease has to be managed. As I said, it cannot be eradicated, it has to be managed. Pest has to be managed. So how do they do the nutrient management? By vermicomposting, composting, soil water conservation, beekeeping, and so on. And then how to handle the product during transport? There is a rule given. Environmental control, there's a rule given. So these all become the part of organic standard of production. Input management, use of ingredients, use of additives and processing aids, packaging and labeling, there's norms given to maintain the organic integrity of the product. Processing, packaging, storage, and labeling is also there given in the NPOP standards. Now, coming to the fourth chapter back, it gives about the procedures accreditation procedures, Goer Group certification, how to use an India organic logo, what are the colors for an Indian organic logo, what are the significance of those colors used in the organic logo. These are all the things which are given in detail in this part. Now, I would like to make it very clear, apart from organic certification, organic food also need to comply to other food safety requirements. ISO 22000, HACCP, management practices, good agriculture practices, Indian food safety standard, they all are above that of organic production certification. Those who go in for organic process product certification, apart from that, they are also required to qualify these requirements of the food safety standards. Scope of certification, what are the products certified as organic? Agriculture products, all crop products can be certified as organic. Wild collection, the forest products can be certified as organic. Processed food products can be certified as organic. And chain of custody, that is the storage, transportation, handling, the entire chain also needs certification. So these are the four scopes wherein organic certification is given by the accredited recognized certification bodies. Recently, Ministry of Commerce have introduced two new products into the certification process. One is aquaculture and one is livestock. All dairy products can be certified, meat can be certified, the fish can be certified, and many other marine products can be certified. These are all given detail in the standards. See, this is the Indian scenario. You can see from this slide, all the states, the 20 states in India can produce, has a potential to produce all varieties of crops because we have different climatic zones, we have different climatic regions. So all varieties of products can be produced, but there are some potential products for potential states. So the organic product portfolio which is now prevailing in India is bulk field crops, that are cereals, pulses, oil seeds and millets, then horticulture crops, animal products, the specialty products are there, and new non-food products, even the textiles, the fiber, the cotton, the silk, they are also coming under organic certification because the concept of ahimsa is followed in case of the textiles. Bees are killed, and even the cocoons, when they extract the silk from the cocoons, you all know the silk is extracted, the cocoons are not killed, so natural way they give. So that is how non-food products are also now under organic certification. Availability, it is there in the market with 60% to 70% premium. On some products even there is 100% premium, and these are available in farmers market, farmer markets near the villages, maximum up to the district level. The farmer markets are there. Retail outlets and supermarkets, it's now entering the retail and supermarkets. Ayurvedic clinics, health stores, supermarkets, they look like this nowadays. Well packed, certified with a label, even though there's no regulation, but people have started recognizing the labels and the process. So earlier it was 100 stores, now it has come to 1000 stores. Most of the metros, they have the supermarkets and modern retail chains. So this is how it is expanding. So organic products can be produced at the farm level. Organic produce can be processed for value addition for more bigger shelf life. And organic products should reach the consumer with details of the product, the product flow that the consumer requires to know that if I pay a premium, how can I be confirmed, how can I be assured that the product is organic through the traceability system. This is a huge picture of organic products I have given you in a nutshell, and I hope you develop an interest in organic products and you develop a passion for that. Thank you.